Fridays. You're vibing with Don Vito Show. I'm your host, Don Vito, the one-man show. How y'all doing? What's up? Summertime is over, but we still got that summer weather, so it's feeling good outside. Thank God, you know. Well, today I got an interesting guest coming on. She goes by the name of Millie Bass. Millie Bass, you know, she's a producer. She's a DJ. She does a lot of different things, modeling and stuff like that. And she's from France. So, you know, she gave me a call. She said, I heard about your show. I heard about your work. And I would love to get on your show. So I did some research on it. I said, you know what? I never had like a DJ, promoter, all in one come on the show. So I was like, you know, and a female at that. So I was like, you know what? Let me go ahead and get on the show. So we have Millie Bass coming on the show. She should be on here in a few minutes. And she's from France. But before we start the show, I want to see how y'all doing, how y'all feeling. You know, summer's over, like I said, but, you know, I hope everybody enjoyed their summer. You know, even with the social distance thing, COVID's still around. You know, we got to wine and dine and party outside. You know, the summer to me went kind of fast because it's different. It's a different vibe. It just ain't the same, you know. And I guess we had to make the best of it, but I'm happy that, you know, the fall season is coming around and maybe some things might open up. Maybe this COVID thing might slide away, fade away a little bit, and we can get back to being normal and stuff like that, you know? But at the end of the day, happy Friday. Thank you for tuning in, vibing with Don Vito Show. We got Millie Bass coming on the show. She's a DJ, she's a different kind of DJ. Whereas, you know, she plays like a lot of interesting type of music, but she knows her stuff. So I want y'all to tune in and just check her out when she come on the show and show her some love. You know, she's from another country, but she's an American citizen now. And, you know, I put on the platform so she could do a thing and we can help showcase her talent. But before we get into that, we're going to talk about her story and see how life was, you know, coming up. A young black female from France, you know, transitioning all the way to the United States of America and making a life and making a career and making a success story out of herself. I see my man Dapper Don 71. What's up, Chan? How you feeling? Thanks for tuning in. Vibing with Don Vito Show. We got a lot of hot guests coming in the next couple weeks. I'm going to show y'all better than I could tell y'all. But right now we got Millie Bass pulling up. I see her right there waving. What's up, baby? How you doing? You know, come on in, click it on, click on the like, and let's go. You gotta request me so I can bring you in. I see you waving. There you go. What's up, Millie? How you doing? How you feeling? Millie Bass, you about to go live.
Okay, you should be coming on right now. What's up, Millie? How are you feeling? Let me move my camera back. Hey, what's good?
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good.
Well, thank you for having me first.
You're welcome. I like your hairstyle. I like your look.
Thank you. It was an accident. I was just experimenting and I just stick to it.
No, it's nice. It's nice. Very Afrocentric, you know?
Yeah.
I like it. Yeah, it's a good look on. You got the face to go with the style and all that, you know? You got the look.
Thank you.
There you go. So before we start the show, how you been? How you doing?
I've been doing okay, you know. We are managing in this pandemic, as you can imagine. You know, trying to make the best out of it, learn, refocus, you know, prioritize. And yeah, but I've been doing okay, thank God.
Yes. So they say the pandemic is a gift and a curse. How was your experience with the pandemic so far?
Totally a gift. And sometimes, you know, a gift is not it's not always supposed to be pleasant. You just have to be able to receive it.
Yes.
Even what everything that happened with George Floyd, and it brought us back together. Because it was the pandemic, I feel like people had to be aware, became more aware of what's going on. That's why the movement was so huge at some point. As far as the pandemic, I do feel like it was a time when people could reconnect with their families, their loved ones, reconnect with themselves in terms of, you know, I mean, personally, I know that I really took the time to work on my craft and also think of what I wanted to do next when this whole pandemic is over.
Yes. And what you said is 100% correct. And that's what I did myself also. Mm-hmm. You know, I just got my creative juices working and just said, damn, so what am I going to do now?
Mm-hmm.
You know, how am I going to make it through this, you know? And everybody else should be doing that. You shouldn't be home worrying and pouting and all stuff like that. Should be trying to step your game up and figure out how you could take it to the next level. Stuff mm-hmm. like that, you know?
Yeah.
Because life is about changes. And when it changes, you got to change. You got no choice.
Mm-hmm. You have to adapt.
Exactly. So tell everybody where you're from.
Okay, so I was born in France. My parents are originally from Côte d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast. Hey, bye. I grew up in France and I came to New York when Obama was elected is when I got my visa. So I came.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But it was like a sign, kind of, you know, okay, this is where I need to be. Uh-huh. And yeah, I came here late December 28th.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how was life? So you born and raised in France?
Yep.
So how was life? What part of France?
Paris in the suburbs.
Okay. So how was life growing up in France as a little girl?
I'm going to say, you know, I'm coming from a close-knit family. So, you know, mom, dad, I have two brothers, one sister, and I was lucky enough to grow up, should I say, like, you know, bougie neighborhood. So the downside of it was that, you know, I was always the only black girl of the situation. You know, the only black, you know, it was only like two or three black people in the school. Mm-hmm. And as far as racism, it was very challenging. I do remember when we first moved in this, you know, in my new apartment, the first time I went to get my keys, the super asked me if I was the maid.
Wow.
No, I'm just coming to get the keys of my apartment. And I was like, you know, I was a teenager, so okay, the maid, or whatever. So I, you know, get my keys, or when I will go to the grocery store, what you will call here a bodega, when I will go to the store in the morning, you know, in the morning you go, you get your candy bars or whatever, or whatnot, and I will go, and the front desk, the cashier wouldn't say hi to me. He would say hi to my friends, but he wouldn't say hi. Or when we tried to enroll in at school, at first the director said, you know, the school for the monkeys on the other side of town, you need to go.
Get the hell out of that.
Like, this is real. But on the other hand, I also met a lot of, you know, all of my friends, I met them during that time. Like one of my best friends, I will go to her house, her parents were British. So I would eat, you know, scones and muffin. So I discovered, and she would come to my house, and my grandmother would have to give her, like, you know, those spicy gravy, and she would eat just because she was curious. So it was, you know, yes, you know, I had the racism, but I also had, like, I met a lot of great people, and we are friends until this day. Still, right. You know.
Right. So everybody over there wasn't racist, pretty much.
Not everybody, no.
Yeah, just certain people.
Yeah.
I just like everywhere then.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's all over the world like that.
Yeah, overall, my childhood was, you know, well, it was good. You know, I was lucky enough to go to pretty beautiful places. For instance, when I was 8 years old, we went on a trip with my school to West Indies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was a great experience. I really loved it. And also because I was already into music through my childhood, you know, I was part of a female group at some point. I was doing shows, you know, for my school at the time. So, yes, you had rough moments, but, you know, I'm not, you know, I can't complain. I was okay.
So pretty much your mother and your father, your family, armed you mentally on how to deal with stuff like that if it happened.
Yeah, so when I was a little girl, first of all, I think that what the great thing that my parents did was that they made us so aware of what was going on. I was very little. I was 6, 7 years old. They had me watching Roots, Shaka Zulu.
Okay.
So like, this is what's going on in the world. You need to be ready, you know.
Yes,
but at
sometimes
they explain to me like, yes, those, you know, this is what's going on, but you also have to be tolerant. And you cannot just think that, you know, all white people are horrible. That's not what it is. But you need to know your story.
Yes.
So I grew up, you know, eating African food, speaking the broken French, and at the same time going outside and also interacting in, you know, in this, you know, with this European culture.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, so you say you were doing shows and stuff when you were young. What were you doing?
I used to sing. Don't ask me to sing. It's not gonna happen. That was a long time ago. I'm done with it. But yeah, I started doing music. My journey as an artist. I used to sing. So I think my first performance. I think I was 8, 9 years old. Then as I continued in middle school and in high school, I met 2 girls. And we created a group. We had, you know, different shows. We did contests. When I was 18, we got picked up by a record label. But the problem was that I believe that at the time, the record label didn't have like a clear vision of what they wanted to do with us.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, I started singing in a gospel choir. So that's why we kind of like, that's how we parted ways.
Okay. Yeah.
That's how we parted ways. And it was, you know, yeah. And then after that, I came to the U.S. because the gospel choir, I think I did it for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I'm really grateful because it develops, you know, I never went to school for music, but it was a form of introduction on, you know, how to listen to music, what is the science behind it. So it was a great experience.
So did that transform you into want to be like a DJ or sort of whatever?
The DJ situation really happened. It was like a truth out there. So basically when I came here, I met like a music producer, independent music producer. And he was, at the time he was looking for a singer. And we went to his studio. And you remember like the MPC-3?
Mm-hmm.
So I started playing around with it, not knowing what I was doing. It's like, yo, hold it. I think you know how to make beat. What is that? So I had no idea. So I started practicing a lot, and I would practice every day. I think I did this for almost a year.
Mm-hmm.
After that, we parted ways with this producer because this wasn't really evolving. And I started working with another producer. And then I started producing songs for a hip hop group. And then I decided to do this on my own. I started, you know, writing songs and working with a producer. 12 Keys, look him up. He's amazing. He's worked with Ashanti, 50 Cent. He is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
So I started working on songs with him, and when it was time to promote them, I would go to see DJs. But now when you go to speak to them, and now I get it because I'm a DJ, you just don't want to play people's music like that, you
right.
know?
Right.
And so one great DJ, his name is DJ Bamboo. He was working at H&M on Times Square. So I went to see him and I was like, you know what? Can you play my song? And he did play my song in the middle of H&M. I was like, oh my God, my song is playing at H&M. Anyway. Mm-hmm. And, but because he was so nice to me at the time, I didn't want to be rude and just be playing my song and then just leave. That was, I didn't like the idea. So I was staying close to him. I was like, why don't you play this? Why don't you play that? Why don't you play this? And he looked at me like, why don't you become a DJ? I was like, no. And I met another DJ of mine. And this one, he was like, you know what? I'm going to teach you. And that's exactly what happened. He showed me, you know, he got the controller. I would come and practice. And that's how it all started. I also had another DJ, DJ YB. I also have DJ Dave. I have a lot of DJs in New York City who really supported me when I started it. Mm-hmm. And and that's, you know, after that, you know, I just, you know, just spread my wings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So once you started DJing and stuff like that, how did you start marketing yourself to get like to do parties and stuff?
The guy who taught me how to DJ was already throwing events. So I already had a platform to start. So when you go to a party, you start playing, someone is gonna come and see you. Hey, can you come and DJ my party? Sure. Can you come and DJ my party? And that's how, you know, and also I didn't mention it before, but before being a DJ, I was already around the Nigerian community because I was working for a radio station called Under the Rock. So I was already around the entertainment. So when it was time for me to become, you know, when I became a DJ, I already had a few contacts that really helped. Because I knew the owner of Under the Rock Radio, he did a show at the Irving Plaza. Mm-hmm. And he gave me a shot. He's like, you know what? I'm going to let you open, see what you can do. You know, so playing at the Irving Plaza after only a year of a career was like, whoa. And I was super grateful for it. Yeah.
So let's talk about that experience working as a radio personality.
Yeah. I studied journalism.
Okay.
So, after, you know, when I was studying for my degree, you know, you have to do certain internships and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I worked for a national radio station back home in Paris. I worked for a TV station. I was doing reports. I even had a show at some point. So I kind of had like some experience. So when I came here, in the middle of me doing music, I met this great guy. His name is Coscanino. And he had the radio station, and I told him, hey, I'm doing some radio. He's like, okay, you know, I have experience. Are you looking for any host or anything? He's like, yeah, I'm going to give you a shot. Mm. Okay. And this lasted for, should I say, 3 years, and we did red carpet. I had the chance to, you know, be a part of the Nigerian Entertainment Awards for 3 years, and it was a very humbling experience.
Mm.
You know, sometimes you think of things, you throw it into the universe, but you just never know how it's going to come back to you. And it definitely did. Yeah. Wow. As a radio host, I was like very serious. I was doing the breaking news, you know, because this is just, you know, how this is what I've learned. I also had a show for a moment where I was talking about different topics. I always try to mix the European and the African culture, probably because this is who I am and how I grew up.
Yes. Yes.
So okay. It was a good experience.
So when you started DJing, mm-hmm. and stuff like that, did you say this is it? This is what I want to do. This is who I want to be. I want to take it to another level. How is it? How did you make it evolve and work for you?
You know what? Whenever I decide to do something, I always try to give it my best. Mm-hmm. I think it's important because I was raised by, my mom was a perfectionist. So whenever I try to do something, I want to do it the right way. as far as being a DJ, I do feel like you really have to work constantly and things will come to you naturally. People will come to you because they see the dedication and the hard work. Mm-hmm. Because it doesn't matter if you decide, okay, this is who I want to be, and you don't put the effort, it's not going to happen.
Right.
You know, I feel like as far as making a decision of what you want to do, it's more into actions. If people, you know, because me personally, I have a certain style. So as you can imagine, I always have to, you know, I did this yesterday, today I have to do better. I have to do better. And people will notice, you know.
Mm-hmm. All right. So the DJ, it's a lot of female DJs out there. Not as many as men, but I salute females when they come into the music game in any shape, form, or fashion. You got something you can play, a little song or something, or you can mix up right there or no? I see something behind you. What's that? I see it. Let's hear something.
Okay. Let's try.
Yeah, let the viewers hear a little music. It's Friday, you know?
Okay.
We normally party on Fridays, you know what I mean? Okay.
Hello, papi, me give a gun. Don't tell me by a cross of all. I see by a two of us. Me come up on it, it's a me come up, the mother people, the guy, the guy, the guy, the guy, the guy, the guy, the oh, Jaja, you're my only Jaja. You put a cat on Jaja.
Okay, okay, okay. What happened? We bring it back. We got an internet connection problem right here, see? Hopefully we come back on. Oh, man, froze. What happened? We got technical difficulties, everybody. Hopefully we come back on. What happened? Oh, there we go. Oh, she went off. We got to bring her back. Millie, you got to come back, baby. Something happened on your side. Let's see if we can get her back on there. Y'all stay tuned, all right? We're going to get it back on the show. Y'all stay right here. Hey, Karen, what's up? How you feeling? Trying to get my guests back on the show. Something happened. Oh, there she go. All right, here we go.
Sorry, we got cut off. My people, people are calling me. I'm like, no.
Yeah, you just got to click them off. But I called you. I called you on other phone to try to get you back on, but we still here. So that was a nice little mix you had going on there, huh?
Thank you.
I like that. So you got a little hip hop with the Afro beats and all that other type of stuff, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. So every DJ got their niche. What's your niche?
I don't. You know what? I love R&B, the 90s. This is where, I'm not gonna say it's my niche because I started with Afrobeat. I'm gonna say open format.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
But my favorite ever, like if you tell me I have an R&B party, I'm like, okay, I'm all in. What time?
Like the R&B. Me too. I love the R&B. I like rap, but I'm an R&B type of a person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how long you been DJing totally?
Since 2018.
Oh, that's it. 2 years.
Yeah. 2 years. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when you came to the United States, you wanted to do what?
At first, I just wanted to be bilingual. You know.
Oh.
Uh-huh. That was the main, you know, the whole purpose was for me to be bilingual and eventually go back home to, you know, bring that with me, but I stayed.
So you came here for education?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So you know, got, yeah, and you liked it over here. You're like, I ain't going back over there.
I ain't going nowhere. No. What I like about New York is, because it's so challenging, it's so competitive, you really have to outdo yourself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and find, you have no choice but to find yourself. I mean, that's how I experienced New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So, you say you get gigs from friends and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, like, do you play hip hop or you just play R&B?
I do play hip hop.
Yeah. So you play everything.
Yeah, whatever, you know. I don't know if I played at Red Roosters many times. Yeah, so you know, at Genie's also, I played mm-hmm. there. Do you know the Cecil?
Yes.
Yeah, I played there many times. Mm-hmm. So as you can imagine, like the crowd is, you know, it's very R&B, it's Harlem, so it's very R&B and hip hop. So
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so you play in all the hot spots in Harlem.
That, you see, that's God. I just happened to be here at the right time, right moment. That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good thing. It's a good thing. Mm-hmm. So you're gonna make New York City your permanent resident?
I don't know. I like to discover new things. So for now, I'll be in New York, but eventually I'm thinking of going back home to Africa. That's the main goal. I want to go home.
You want to go back home?
Yeah, because I do feel like, you know, considering the history that my African community has, no, it doesn't matter where you're from, West Indies, America, Europe, I feel like, you know, Africa has a lot of potential, and we have to go back and build. Not for me, for the next generation. Very important.
Yes. What part of Africa?
Côte d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast. I want to go back to my country. I already, you know, have a few contacts there because it's all about who you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the plan.
So with the Black Lives Movement, that we've been experiencing for the last couple of months.
Mm-hmm.
How did it affect you?
Oh, I went and protest many times. You wake up and I will wake up sometimes and be very angry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would be very, very, very angry, not understanding the lack of empathy of certain people who,
mm-hmm.
you know, but then you have to remember that growing up around, you know, around white people taught me that that's how they are raised. They're, you know, not all of them, but some of them, for those who don't have that empathy to understand our struggle, is because they are raised very entitled. And they're raised already, they are being told and taught that they're superiority. So it's really hard for them to even grasp or understand what we are going through. They don't understand it.
Right.
They can't.
Mm.
You know, that's why you have this All Lives Matter or Blue Lives Matter. They can't understand because they've never experienced being judged based on the color of their skin. So, you know, to them is you speaking to them Chinese when mm-hmm. and to explain that to them. But on the flip side, like, you wake up and you're very angry. So what, like, the first march that they had on Atlantic Avenue, because the COVID was really, like, you know, we're still on lockdown, you know, mm-hmm. I went there with my bicycle and I stayed for a couple of minutes and I left. And the second day I came on my bicycle, I stayed a little longer, then I left. And the third day, then I marched.
Mm.
It was, like, you know, progressive, but it, you know, every morning I would feel like I can't stay home. I just can't. Mm. I need to go.
Right.
Like, you know, and it's not even about me. It's about my nephews, my partner, my cousins, my friends. It could, you know, sometimes we are so into ourselves that, you know, we make the mistake of thinking that it can only happen to others. It can never happen to us.
Exactly. I tell people that all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Until it does, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it was it's still rough. You know, now you are scared, worried about, you know, turning on the TV because you don't know what you will be told. You don't know what's gonna happen when you go on Instagram. What's new today? Like, who? It's sad to say, but who got killed today? And it's like, oh, do I want kids in this environment? Like, do I want to raise a son and be worried if he goes outside to be at the wrong place at the wrong moment? Do I really want that? I don't know if you remember the movie Beloved.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that movie when she killed her baby because she didn't want her baby to go through slavery?
Right.
That was a while, like Oprah Winfrey, right? And at the time, you know, I didn't understand. Now, not that I condone it, but I kind of, like, I get it.
Mm.
As a woman, when you have a baby, you want the best for him. And think our circumstances today, are better, but think of what it was back then, because that happened, yeah. The beloved story, it really happened. It happened a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But like even right now, sometimes I'm wondering, like, do I really want that? Because it's scary. We live in a very scary world.
That's true.
Yeah.
Imagine me as a black man. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Every day I gotta be thinking, you know. Every day. Like you said, yeah. people think it can't happen to them. They think it only happens in movies and on television.
Mm-hmm.
Until one day you get put in a situation and it happens to you, it's like, what are you gonna do?
Mm-hmm.
How are you gonna respond, you know?
Yep.
So I get it.
Yeah.
I get it.
But also I do feel like us, I don't like to say black people, because if you go back to the history, black people was a term used because slave owners didn't want to like be specific on our origin. So I like to say African people.
Yes.
You know, African Americans, Africans, sometimes the interaction is kind of like complicated. I've heard many times, you know, African-American be like, oh, you African people, what are you saying? We're the same.
Yes, we're the
and
same.
Until we learn how to really get together, it's going to be very hard for us.
Yes, yeah, I agree.
You know? But it's not a problem that only happens here in the U.S. Even in Africa, between ethnic group, you have the same problem. Look what happened in Rwanda.
Yeah.
And even those sometimes, are you familiar with the story of Liberia?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the former slaves will go back to Africa and basically inflict the same thing to the, you know, to the natives. Yeah.
That's crazy.
You see what I'm saying? So it's a lot of trauma that us as Africans, we have to deal with. Really have to deal with that.
Mm. We are our own worst enemy. I say it all the time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just to give you an example, one of my friends was trying to organize a march during, you know, the George Floyd. And we were on 125th. And the Black Panthers movement was there. We happened to be there at the same time. So there was like a little conflict. And granted, you know, the Black Panthers movement, they had every right to be upset because, you know, we happened to be there at the same time and my friend organized the event. I think that he didn't coordinate the event properly. Mm-hmm. However, the way the Black, you know, this movement, the way they treated us wasn't nice either.
Oh, wow.
You know?
What did they do? What did they do?
So, you know, on 125th, you have, like, this statue. So they set up their DJ there. And me, I was on a truck. So I was playing music. And he comes to me, you need to stop playing the music. We have... And I'm like, me? I don't know. I'm just a DJ. And I was asked to come for this march. I don't know if the organizers coordinated the event properly, I don't know. But all I know is like right now you're being very rude to me for no reason. You could have asked me nicely and it wouldn't have been a problem. But right, because right, I right. know that anger, like relax. Because why are you here for? You're here for a reason. We are here for the same reason.
Yes, yes.
You see, and like even if like I do feel like the people I was working with didn't organize the event the way they should have. On the other side, the way the and we're talking about the Black Panthers, so it's like, you know, you are iconic. Show how noble you are. We could have done this together or whatever it is, but because like it was like this is ours. But that's the other problem, because now certain groups make this about them. It's not about you. It's about all of us.
Exactly. Exactly. Wow.
So
yeah. that just happened.
Yeah, it happened. I think it was in July. Not that, you know, again, not that we were right, but it was the way it was addressed. that I was like, I was, we need to, do, we really need to do better. Right. Even like where I'm from, because I'm from this ethnic and that person is from that ethnic, it's always, but it's something that was designed centuries ago, and it's going to take centuries to fix this, really.
Yeah, you couldn't have said it no better.
Yeah.
Yeah, you couldn't have said it no better. Yeah. So musically, right, what do you have that you trying to create that you have going on that people don't know about?
Oh, so right now I'm working on this, because if you go on my page, you see that I always, I have like this chocolate box mix. Mm-hmm. So the concept behind the chocolate box, I love the movie Forrest Gump, and I love the quote. Yeah. You know, I'm always say life is like a chocolate box. You don't know. So, anyway, the chocolate box, the concept around it is like, you know, because I'm coming from so many different, you know, angles as far as music, you never know what's gonna happen. You never know musically where I'm gonna go. You just have to just listen. So right now, during the confinement, I was listening to music and I became very nostalgic of French hip hop. So I decided to do a mashup, and it's only going to be French hip hop. So I'm gonna mix French hip hop with Afrobeat, with hip hop, with R&B, you name it. So that's the plan.
I don't know if I ever heard French hip hop before.
Really?
No.
You have a lot of like.
You got a play a French hip hop song. You got one?
Oh boy.
Just play one.
Yeah, sure.
Let me hear something.
Okay. Which one am I going to pick? There's so many.
And just play one of the hottest ones. Let me see what you got.
Hold on.
We lost her, folks. Oh, I think we lost her. I think she's going to come right back on. We're going to hear this song. French hip hop. I want to hear what French hip hop sound like. Hey, B, what up, champ? I see you, champ. What's good? How you, brother? Where my girl at? Millie Bass, where you at? Come back on. You got to bring her back, folks. Where's she at?
Ah, we got cut off.
Yeah, I see. Where you at?
Yeah.
You got the song? Let me see.
Did you hear? You didn't hear it?
Nothing.
Okay.
Bordel, quand on rentre sur la piste. On est venu teaser, claquer du pif. Pendant Bruyman, pas de litige. Sinon ça va saigner, est-ce que tu pisses? Oh t'es, lâche en l'air sur la piste. MC gardez la pêche, vous n'êtes pas sur la liste. C'est pas la rue mais l'être humain qui m'attriste. Comment leur faire confiance, ils ont tué le Christ. Les rappeurs m'envient, sont tous en galère. Un jour que mon salaire, c'est leur assurance vie. Oh. J'suis pas dans le game pour les tapas. Je la suis Adidas, frais comme Elina Paz. On bloque bizarre avec mon bébé, hein. Condamné au mic à la vente de substances bizarres. Manque de faux, j'ai pris la vie dans mes bras. Je vais les tirer du doigt, je vais les casser les tours.
Dans la ville de Paris, y'a le chez Soli, quand on veut un fatigue, y'a amusé avec un DJ top célébrité. Mais c'est White Mose, carré sur le groupe. J'aime les gars, surtout quand les gars mourent.
So I played you like, I went to different eras, but the last one is like, it's a classic.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
That's that French hip hop, huh?
Yeah, so I've been working for 2 months. You know, I thought that it was going to take me like 2-3 days. Now it took me 2 months. Right. And I want to make it like a visual, like, you know, a video. Mm-hmm. Hopefully by the end of September, I will, you know, put it on social media. Because I don't want to, you know, this DJ life thing is cool and everything, and I get it. But I want to do something that's going to stick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, something that, you know, I'm such a, you know, I like masterpiece. Like, you know, I'm in this artistic mood where I'm just going to be like, you know, let me just do this the right way.
And listen, I like what you got. It's different. It's unique. It's your own. You know what I'm saying? And like, music is diverse and it's versatile. So you bringing that to the table is something totally different. Afro beats and all that Caribbean countries and music is really popping right now. It's always been popping, but it's going to another level. I see.
Yeah,
right?
Definitely.
Yeah. So can you tell everybody your social media links where they can find you at, your music and all that stuff? Whatever.
You can follow me on Instagram. I am Millie Bass. I also have a SoundCloud page. I am Millie Bass. Twitter, Millie Bass as well. And yeah.
All right.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. Definitely welcome. I want everybody that's tuning in to follow this young lady, Millie Bass. You know, she a very hot DJ. She got a lot going on. You know, she's doing some big things out there. Support her. You know, go to her page, like and share it. You know, y'all going to see her around. You know, she got some things that's going on. Right, Millie?
Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. We're going to talk real soon. I thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome and have a great weekend.
You too. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
Bye.